Please like, subscribe and share. Your likes and shares can help us take Athenaeum and Northeast to the world. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and stay connected on Facebook for regular content.
Okay, so hello and welcome to the Athenaeum. Today we have here with us Bhupendra Guru. Bhupendra sir is one of the entrepreneurs in the education sector in Sikkim. To give his bio, he completed his BBA in aircraft maintenance engineering from RGMCA Jaipur, and then after that he completed his MBA from Sikkim Manipal. So welcome Bhupendra sir.
Thank you.
Okay, so let me ask you, can you start with your institute, the Accelerator? Can you just give an introduction, what it is and how did you founded it?
Okay, the Accelerator Academy was basically a blessing in disguise for me. In fact, when we started it with an objective to, looking forward to empower the youth, especially in the education sector. So Accelerator Academy, it's just one part of it. We also have a Northeast Career Guide magazine as well. The main objective of starting it was, me being well polished with my academics during my school days, could not receive a proper guidance in terms of, career and stuff and thing. So I thought, if I am actually facing such problem where I was academically sound, there are so many other students who are actually facing the same. In fact, there are a lot of other students who are average or below average, and they are absolutely directionless in terms of their career. So then we thought, we would like to, serve the society also at the same time, start something which would, not just help our youth in terms of deciding what career would suit them the best, but also at the same time ensuring that they reach the finish line with their guidance. That's how we started Accelerator. And Accelerator Academy, we are into academics, we are into coaching, but we are also into career counseling. We are also into lots of other activities like taking students for an excursion, giving them an insight on how a college campus actually looks like, a proper infrastructure, giving them an idea about how a proper university functions. So we do that at a very, very nominal, registration fee from the students. The career counseling has been taking place, it's been taking since last 8-9 years, and we've been serving almost around, so far we've served almost around 20,000 plus students.
Okay, I'll come to guidance and counseling part little bit later, but first, as you have, you founded the Accelerator in 2013, it has already been 7-8 years now. So in your experience, has there been any difference since the time you began the institute and at least pre-COVID times, has there been any growth in education sector in Sikkim?
If you're talking about this COVID times, I think education sector is declining every day. In fact, we've not been able to open our office since last 14 months. That's how the government has instructed us. In fact, private institutions have not been open to, not been allowed to open. But when you're talking about pre-COVID times, when things were all normal, we could make a difference because, just imagine a student who actually studies in a school for a year and does not, understand the concept of a particular subject. We happen to do that in a span of just 2 months, and that too on a very regular basis. So that's how we're looking forward to, looking forward to execute the academic course. But if you're talking about COVID times, Sikkim is still lacking in terms of technology, and the anticipation of technology has been very less. When we say that everything has to be online, the studies has to be online, we've tried doing that also. But the real impact has not been there. For example, if I look forward to, let's say, take a class of a student who is there face to face with me and I teach them something, I know that the student's attention is there with me. But in online, I cannot grab the student's attention through online, And that's where we are missing out. And moreover, because of the fact that Sikkim is still not, though we talk about 4G, 5G technology, it's still not executed in proper areas. I mean, if you talk about rural areas, There are still areas where not even 2G works. So, you know, imparting this education through online during this COVID times has been really, really very difficult. Not in terms of just business, but also in terms of the fact that education has lost its the value, because you know, meritorious students, whether they receive guidance or not, they will look forward to, obviously, you know, study well. But we're talking about students who actually need guidance, proper guidance in terms of coaching and stuff and things. So in that particular aspect, I think COVID times, the education has, the quality of education has really declined a lot.
Okay, so I mean, this is happening everywhere, right? Not only in Sikkim, but what about the pre-COVID era, before COVID? Like you said, with your own experience, that I mean, when you were a student, that you did not get proper guidance, proper counseling for your, you know, for the studies, higher studies, right? So I mean, when you look at you as a student, the environment or the education sector as a whole, right, when you were as a student, and now, what are the differences do you see? What are the area of improvement? Something that you try to bring in with your advocacy or with your institution itself.
Okay, see, I passed out my class 12 from Holy Cross Senior Secondary School here in Sikkim in the year 2003. So at that particular era, what happened was, I had secured almost around 90% in my CBSE boards class 10, I still had to appear for an entrance examination to get through this premium institution like Holy Cross School. It's still the same. They will have to again, but again, there are a lot of loopholes where people have understood the loopholes and they've bypassed that. And it's not only that, you know, academically sound students will get into premium institutions. They will look forward to get into premium institutions with other loopholes as well. Now, coming back to your question, where you're talking about the fact that what is the difference in our era as far as education is concerned and what is the situation right now. See, what has happened is in our time and today's time, I think more or less everything is the same, but the pressure of education to the students have eased out a little bit. We were like really pressurized in terms of bringing in good numbers. In fact, everything was all about academics. It's all about numbers. If we do not score good marks, we knew that we would not get a good college and stuff and things. So that is there even prominently, existing today as well. The only thing that I feel about the education system, not just in Sikkim, but everywhere in India also, is the fact that if you take it as a personal exercise, then, you know, for example, let's say I had a teacher who actually guided me from my primary stages to my secondary school, to my senior secondary school. But what happened was they were holding my hand and they were taking me and they were telling me, see, you're good in studies, so you need to take science and stuff and things. They used to guide us. But when it comes down to, you know, choosing a college, college is a diverse, it's a very diverse field. There are so many things that you can do in your college, not just pursue a science and become a doctor or an engineer or something like that. You know, it's a diverse thing. So what happens is when somebody holds your hand throughout for a span of 12 years when you're a student in your school, and all of a sudden that guidance is lost, and then you say that now you are like 15, 16 years old and you've become matured enough, you can take decision on your own. As a 16, 17 year old kid, I don't think we are mature enough to take decisions on our own. So I feel we still need that holding hand where they will guide us and tell us, you know, you need to do this, you need to research this, you need to study about this and understand whether it suits your strength. And, you know, you look forward to understand your weaknesses and say that I cannot execute this on a longer run. You know, let's say in a span of 5 years after pursuing this course, you will see yourself in this particular field. That is lacking right now in the education section right now here, not just in Sikkim, I think all over India.
Hey, just now you were talking about, how students, even after their school, maybe are not mature enough to take decision by their own because of their age also, right? So on that point, I would also like to ask, from Sikkim at least, we keep on hearing that students got into quote unquote fake universities, and because of which they had are having problem right now, right? So on that part, what do you think should be done, and what you as an institution are doing about it?
Okay, that's a very important question. That's a very big question. See, normally what happens is, I'm just talking about Sikkim. Every year we are witnessing almost around 8,000 to 10,000 students who are passing out their class 12 every year. And out of them, I'm sure, again, because you also belong from this region, you realize this fact that 80 to 90% of the students that we are mentioning here belongs to the government sector, because that is how the trend works here in Sikkim. We have almost around 90% of the schools who are government, under the government banner, and then always around 10 to 12%, which is under the private institutions banner. But obviously, the boards that we're talking about that they are under is CBSE, and then maybe 2% to 5% is like ICSE and ISC. Yeah? So when we talk about this, identification of universities in terms of which is proper, which is not, and because of the fact that marketing has become so easy these days on social media and stuff, and think they look forward to actually, market themselves in such a way that, everyone is number one. We are all accredited. We are all NAC accredited. They actually do bluff about all those things. Now, as far as we looking forward to filter whether this institution is proper or not, is the fact that we ask them, it's very important for the student or the parent who actually is looking forward to, admit the student there. They need to understand the A class, B class, and C class. See, A class is all those premium institutions. Like, if you're talking about engineering, we're talking about IITs, we're talking about NITs. Those are all A premium institutions, which does not require any, submission of their profile. We already know that they are A class institutions, and that is why you're appearing for entrance examinations, competitive examinations on a national scale, where they have to sit, and then when they crack that examination, then you get into those premium institutions. But when you're talking about, all those meritorious students who actually get into it, there are hardly 20% of the students will get into such. But 80% of the students will still want to pursue that particular subject, and they will opt for, courses in other colleges and universities who they feel is at par with premium institutions, which they are not actually. For example, you're talking about private universities like, for an example, Sharda University or Lovely Professional University or SRM University, for that sake. They are private universities, but they are A accredited private universities. Now, what happens with the students is because of the marketing, effect on them, they tend to make decisions where they choose the wrong university just because of the hype that they receive. And we are looking forward to identify and understand that, if I am counseling a particular student, I'm advising a private university, I make it a point to ensure that they give me proper documentation, where they give me all those accreditation, they give me a proper, format, where they actually give me a possibility of at least ensuring me that this is my 5 years placement record also of my students in my university. So I do all those things, and then you as a smart student, you should also look forward to use the internet efficiently, so that you can go to the UGC website and see whether that particular university or website, your college is registered under that particular the authority where the government actually counsels everything. So it's very important that we do that,
Okay, in your experience, how do you think students right now in terms of COVID-19, where we have to be completely dependent upon this, digital media, right? So how do you think students are taking education? I mean, what are their thought process right now?
Right now, JC, the thought process is very, very limited. Everywhere, I think right now, because of this COVID pandemic, what has happened is, I'm sure you realize the fact that Sikkim, let's just give an example only of our region, Sikkim. Because again, you also belong to our region, so you completely understand this fact that we have very limited career choices here inside our territory. But because of the pandemic, now the students are forced or compelled to choose whatever is available only inside our territory, you know, because because of the pandemic, you don't want to travel, you don't want to go outside your state. But the students and parents don't realize the fact that till the time this pandemic ends, the medium of education is still going to be online. So whether you take admission in Andhra Pradesh or in Bangalore or in Sikkim, you will still have to sit at your home and then take the education, you know. That is something which we are, our people are, you know, the mentality of our people is like, you know, we have to stay inside Sikkim because of this pandemic. I don't want my son or daughter to go outside. So that's why, you know, whatever is available inside Sikkim, you choose that. Or some of the people are very wise students. What they're doing is they're trying to drop 1 year or 2 year so that they can, you know, they can have enough time to understand what their potentials are. And they would like to prepare for such, you know, national level competitive examination so that they can get into premium institutions. But other students, whoever would like to see themselves pursuing their career ahead or their education ahead in terms of college, they're looking forward to compromise. See, that's the word. They're compromising because of this pandemic. Students have started compromising.
Ruben, sir, I think you again went mute.
Limited resources inside Sikkim.
Okay, okay.
That's how things are going.
Okay. What about teachers? I mean, in this time, how are teachers coping with, I mean, usage of technology for teaching their students?
It's actually extremely difficult for the teachers in also, because, you know, we try to, for example, right now the meeting that we are conducting is through this Zoom. I have actually encouraged most of my staff members to use technology to execute your classes, but it's really difficult for them, and I don't blame them at all. You know, the anticipation of technology has come all of a sudden for them, and it's also difficult for them to, you know, execute it. And moreover, you know, the kind of response that they receive from the students over the internet when they're conducting classes is extremely it's not in their control at all, you know. For example, let's say I'm a teacher and I'm conducting a class, and you are a student, and all of us, when I'm actually teaching you something, you just disappear. I can't control you. I cannot shout on you, and I cannot say pay focus, you know, give me your attention. I cannot do that, you know. That's what my teachers are also lacking, and it's actually so sad that you know, due to this pandemic, It was always advised to us that technology would be the future, but we did not realize that it would come so soon, you know.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, at least from my experience, what I can say is that because I'm in the university campus and my university SRM provides good connectivity, internet connectivity, we have Wi-Fi, which is free for us, right? So we can also, you know, search for YouTube materials, video materials to make our classes interesting and different kind of materials, right? Which then we can just imagine, first I have to see the video myself and many other content online, which means I have to spend data, right? Which also cost money. But because university is giving me free of cost, I can do that. As many video I can watch, as many data I can access, and then show it to the students also. So that is why I actually asked, because in Sikkim, now data, I feel, is again, you know, going back to that price level higher and higher, because now network providers are only giving 1 or 2 GB per day. So in this very limited resources, I mean, I think it's quite difficult, right? So how are you coping with it?
See, what we are doing is, right now I'm not in a situation financially to provide to my staff members, because to even survive my office has become a really difficult task.
Yes.
But yes, when you're talking about providing those resources to our staff members in order to ensure that their exercises are executed efficiently, we had been providing them with at least 50% of salary on a monthly basis, where they could look forward to also execute all these important activities like recharging their phone in terms of executing their work and taking their classes where they need to, you know, recharge and everything. We were doing that. But, you know, this thing has really extended so much. And I look forward to also encourage my staff members to come to the office, because that is where you find the Wi-Fi. The internet is absolutely free at my office. But again, because of the government's protocol, we are not able to open the office, you know, so that's a major concern here.
Oh, exactly. So, I mean, in, you just now mentioned that you are in a place where you can only offer a certain amount of salary, right? So, what has been the impact of COVID-19 in your revenue generation?
When talking about revenue generation right now in the education sector, see, our revenue generation would be through obviously collecting, you know, tuition fees from the students, counseling fees from the students, admission processing fee towards their college, as in college advisors also. Everything has become stagnant right now. As I told you, students have limited and compromised their career avenues only to the territory that we are living in right now. And I'm sure you also realize the fact that Sikkim is number one in the Northeast as far as this COVID, you know, pandemic transmission is also concerned. And then it's just the mentality, the students and the parents, they feel they will have to sit inside Sikkim. I would also like to say that the government has not really been very serious about the education sector, where they know that when India actually first received its independence was because of the fact that people were educated enough and the education was the priority. Now the same scenario is coming in, but the government apparently has been taking education on a very secondary level, where they should be taking education on a primary level. Because whenever there is a little bit of relaxation in terms of, you know, you can go around, you can open this, restaurants open, you know, the dancing classes open, clubs are open, gymnasium, gyms are open. But education sector in terms of private institutions where we look forward to cater to almost around what 80 to 100 students, they are not allowed to function. So it's a really difficult time right now.
Okay, actually, I was going to come to the government's role. I mean, this time during COVID-19, you are also having reduced revenue, right? So, has there been any kind of help?
Zero revenue.
Has there been any help from the authorities or the government?
No. See, what happened again was last year the government formed this one committee called Economic Revival Committee. Yeah, and then what they did is they actually had a meeting with almost every organization of different business class, where we also came into play. And as a general secretary of my All Sikkim Association and Training Coaching Institute Association, I represented my association. I went to attend that meeting, and we had placed some few demands, or rather say our request, where we told them that, you know, because of this pandemic, the first and foremost thing is 90% of the people who are engaged in the coaching sector, they do not possess their own property. We are all rented property. So we requested this Economic Revival Committee under the government banner to at least appeal to the landlords. You don't have to specify or say that, you know, you need to you know, relax or give them complete you know, relaxation in terms of the rent. But we just appealed to the government, saying that from the government banner, if you could actually appeal to the landlords of the businesses, not just ours also, but we were talking about ourselves under our banner, if you could just appeal to the landlords that whatever you could you know, relax in terms of their rents are concerned, You could please do that. You know, if the government is telling us we have a proof and we can go and talk to the landlord and say that, see, that even the government is appealing to you. So please kindly consider our situation right now and then kindly consider our rent for this month or next month or till this pandemic declines or, you know, completely gets over. That was placed forward. We also spoke about the fact that, if you're talking about only class 10 or class, see, major guidance over here in Sikkim, actually, guidance requires from a very younger age. But the trend and tradition that actually works here in Sikkim is only when a student actually reaches class 10 and class 12, then you think that we need to put the student in a coaching center or something like that. So at least if you're talking about only class 10 and class 12, we're talking about 8,000 students, 10,000 students. And then the registered coaching institute here in Sikkim is more than 500, 600, 700. So if one coaching center is looking forward to cater to 100 or 200 students, this 500, 600 coaching centers will look forward to cater to this 8,000 students also. So even if you don't open the school, our coaching institute, you know, abiding by the guidelines of the COVID protocol, we will look forward to execute this. You just allow me to, you know, execute only just 50 students or 60 students in a month. With our proper spacing thing. So that's what we actually, requested the government to do. But so far, the government has been almost sleeping in terms of the education sector, especially the private sector. We've not received any help so far. We've not received any financial aid. We've not received any emotional support. We've not received anything that... whatever we could do, we have been receiving zero support from the government.
Okay. So I think we have come to the end of our talk. So I'd like to once again thank Bhupendra sir very much. Thank you, Bhupendra sir, for talking with us, for talking with the Ethereum.
Thank you so much for this opportunity again. Thank you.
And I would also like to thank all the viewers. Thank you very much.
If you liked our video and you wish to continue watching it, please like, share and subscribe Athenaeum.